Tonight I would like to introduce two guys from Vienna to you. Peter Kogler, a multimedia artist. His breakthrough came when he participated at the Documenta with a big piece of ant farms, I would say. I'm still asking why you like ants so much. Maybe you can solve this riddle for me in your lecture. And the second guy, not the second one, but the multimedia artist, Gregor Eichinger. He's a, no, not a multimedia artist, he's a multimedia architect. And one architect who can connect seemingly disconnected topics. We invited them to support us at the topic of the studio we are teaching here, Caroline and me, namely open system. They will do lectures not about these open systems, but by showing their work, maybe we can clarify what it meant, what it means, open system in art and architecture. There's a lot of variety to get two guys into one lecture. We discussed it very heavily. I wanted them to do a parallel lecture, simultaneous talking, but they said no good idea. Then I wanted to exchange the images. I had that experience a long time ago with Rob Krier. We confused our slides, and Rob Krier had to talk about my architecture, and that was easy. And I had to talk about his architecture. So we decided to throw the dice, and the first will be Gregor Eichinger. Gregor Eichinger, a good friend of mine. I know him since long time. When he was a student, he came to our office and presented us a project he was doing on the Technical University where he was studying architecture. It was a hotel for motorcycles, I think, like that. And since then, he was crazy enough to love him. Now, he is teaching in Munich after teaching on this School Applied Art University in Vienna and many others. And he's working on architecture and design, or vice versa, on design and architecture. So it will be lovely to see what he's doing. When he shows up in our office, how does that work? Michael.
Right button.
Thank you. We always have big discussion about architecture, and sometimes we have very hard arguments about the future of architecture. Sometimes the older one slaps the younger one, but at the very end, we are very happy that we can solve problems by jumping into a glass of water. Gregor, please, your stage.
With your mercury mouth in the missionary times, and your eyes like smoke, and your prayers like rhymes, and your silver cross, and your voice like chimes. Oh, who do they think could bury you? With your pockets well protected at last, and your streetcar visions, which you place on the grass, and your flesh like silk, and your face like glass. Who could they get to carry you?
Both, thank you very much for your introduction. Now being back out of this glass of water.
Yeah.
I saw these photos for the first time. Hello, everybody here in the CAC lecture hall and the Benutzers out there online. I know there are some people online. This is brilliant. And thanks for these remarks and for inviting me to share these aspects of architecture and generating space under the inspiring epitaph you chose, open systems and their enemies. And your remarkable sentence, if you only think architecture, it will be only architecture. I want to briefly outline that we are so closely connected to architectural space that we have to handle this relationship carefully. And what we see here is the sharpness we apply dealing with the topic today. It's far away from 4K. As a fashion model, presenting at the same time all the London fashion trends of the summer of 2012. And maybe we can take this image as a quick summary of this lecture. And before we start the lecture and talk about the title, I want to quickly show you something. Our daily life takes place, as we all know, in continuous series of built spaces. We are surrounded by surfaces, and this Benutzeroberfläche, as I want to call it, the user interface designed by architects, is the very part of architecture which is in intimate contact with body and psyche of each and every one of us. When we speak of architecture today, mostly aspects of city planning, huge building complexes, building with breathtaking construction experiments will come to our mind. And nearly every project that we start as a large form must eventually end up in the human scale. Big scale architecture and interior design pursue the same goal, the complex structure of human perception and emotion. Therefore, the Benutzeroberfläche, the user interface of architecture, tells us the whole story, makes us our world comprehensible, and touches us deeply. The city, the people, the Zeitgeist, culture in general, our epoch we live and experience is carefully woven into this surface. Most of the projects start in the design process with the envelope, the dress. The building starts as a dancer in the street and the project's staff direction, interior, and further, mostly after defining some technical surfaces, the project dies. Result, architecture with no proper user interface. We know that these spaces and rooms are addressing us physically and spiritually, and we feel that they have a tight grip on us. To a coming perception theory today, it is comprehensible that we never perceive only isolated bodies, but whole situations. We experience not only the geometric aspect of architecture, but also its background program. Programs like here, as an example, we see movements and body language designed by a narrow floor plan. In this case, a typical apartment of Hong Kong where two families are living on 20 square meters together. floor plans needed you slim and fluid, and so was the congenial fashion. Years later, fashion looks like you likes you to look massive. This fashion follows the body awareness of the basketball game, where you have to use as much space as possible to block the Angreifer, the attacker. And why basketball? Because we all wear sneakers now, which are now the shoes related to architecture, shoes with rubber soles that go well with concrete floors and seamless poured surfaces. Rubber soles which are also able to transport lifestyle and culture. When our ancestors were walking barefoot, it was clay which was the seamless surface in their habitats, and later on marble they worked with sandals. Here we have some sandals of a gladiator. And indoors, the softness of the thin leather sole matched with the mosaic floors of EG here, the Roman villa. And later on, when the floor surfaces changed, stiff shoes were created to work as instruments to measure the dimension of space and the materials of the surface over the acoustic they produced to give architecture a sound, like here in the Eremitage in St. Petersburg.
Мрамор белый-белый, камень. Как-то холодно, а?
Когда вам показывали дворец, наверное, здесь был полный разгром, ведь это было после
And we are so accustomed to moving amid surfaces that we classify either as self-evident or as insignificant, and mostly we are unaware that we perceive surfaces with the help of our shoes. But as soon as we start to consider this more carefully, we see that these surfaces represent the entire world and its history. Space, the user interface of architecture, is in a permanent process of being inscribed and interpreted by us. So wherever we go, we always travel with our own enriched and charged space. To understand built space surrounding us, we have to use our whole body impression possibilities and not believe in a reality which is delivered only by our stupid eyes. And we have to take the time we need to establish our perception, because with a strawberry cake, you can have a quick orgiastic affair, but with architectural space, as I said in the beginning, you are always dealing with a long-term relationship. If you are in a space you like to be, even if it's just a wooden shack, you will feel this love addressing you, and this is the best thing in the world. Suddenly there's a place that loves you and that you love too. To achieve that, it's normal to be physically curious, to be radical, and whilst allowing yourself the distance you need. The process of generating a project is of interest for us. In our moment, because we learn to know our demons and our desires, we work so long on a task that we will surprise ourselves. The results finally built is only for the client. Let us have a look at some of my projects. examining existing buildings with our eyes only is either feeding our jealousy or training of our impotence. Because if you're not interested in the woven cultural structure of the user interface, we will not get it, and it's a waste of time to examine these buildings, in this case a waste of knownness. Working on the Benutzeroberfläche is touching our innermost, shows our heartstrings, our personal, cultural, social capacity. Our 3D perception was primarily developed by our ancestors to navigate on the run before carnivores. Let us now use this ability to understand how life is woven into architecture and be open for all varieties of genius and shit. When we close our eyes and remember ecstatic emotional moments, we are looking into the future, because these intimate moments represent us in every moment, past, present, future. This is all we have, together with the architecture surrounding us. We fill these spaces with life, and in terms of ecstasy, time does not count, so what we experience is eternal. When working on the Benutzeroberfläche, we are creating physical presence of space, not only with solid matter, but also with memories and feelings. The result is we become visible, which always causes trouble. The user surface of architecture triggers our body memory, is diverse, and should understand our needs intelligently. We can find all kinds of different emotional approaches and merge them, and one does not exclude the other, just as it is in music, where there is a large variety to express emotion.
You know, every now and then I think you might like to hear something from us, nice and easy. But there's just one thing. You see, we never ever do nothing nice and easy. We always do it nice and rough. But we'll take the beginning of the song and do it easy. But then we're gonna do the finish rough. That's the way we do. Creedence Clearwater's Proud Men. And we're rolling on the river. Listen to the song.
Left a good job down in the city, working for the man every night and day. But I never lost one minute of sleep, and I was worried about the way the thing might have been. They will keep on turning, primary keep on burning, and we're rolling,
rolling,
rolling, yeah,
rolling,
rolling on a river,
rolling on the river.
Say we're rolling.
I wandered around and finally found There's somebody who could make me be true, could make me be blue, and even be glad just to be sad thinking of you.
On the page, it looked nothing. The beginning simple, almost comic. Just a pulse, bassoons, basset horns, like a rusty squeeze box. And then, suddenly, high above it, an oboe. A single note hanging there, unwavering. Until a clarinet took it over. Sweetened it into a phrase of such delight. This was no composition by a performing monkey. This was a music I'd never heard. Filled with such longing, such unfulfillable longing. It seemed to me that I was hearing a voice of God. Excuse me.
We will find a surprising intelligence concerning our physical and emotional needs of today. That means humans did not change a millimeter in the way they emotionalize since Stone Age. In using architecture, each user can have their say, individually valid judgment and an emotional state. Nobody is free from his feelings, even being a troglodyte like many clients. We have to face ignorant people, talent-free colleagues who comment us in the world that tries to sell up emotion, like the church wants to regulate sex, altogether a shitstorm of contemporary officials of lower average, the level they understand and want to conserve. Looking at our past on the level of emotion is in many ways remembering the future. Hence, this is the title of the lecture, Remembering the Future, and
thanks, Gregor. It's always good to make a swan dive into A glass of water. Thanks for the speechless lecture. I liked it, actually. I have to consider that in my lecture. Not talking only music. I would love to do that. Anyway, so Peter Kogler, a good friend of mine. I think we met when you were and I was in LA here. We met there first time. And we are doing projects together, which I, he will show and I will show a little bit. Peter Kogler is, as I said, a visual artist. He's also a teacher. He's teaching now in Munich. He was running a masterclass at the Academy of Fine Art for Video and Graphic. And he is exhibiting extensively all over the world. I think in every good museum you had your exhibition, and if a museum doesn't invite you, it's the fault of the museum, I think. As I mentioned it before, his breakthrough was the Documenta, the contribution, the Ant Farm, a big wallpaper piece. And we worked together the first time at the Biennale, at the Art Biennale in Venice. We had to rearrange, remodel this Austrian pavilion, and Peter was invited to make the inside. And he came with 10 rolls of paper and finished his work. You can see that on the wall, and changed the pavilion more dramatically than we did. And this is the picture, shows how architecture space comes to an architectural wall. And I think this, his work reminds me every time I see it, whether it's moving or whether it's static, reminds me on the tradition of the Baroque paintings, where the guys did cupolas, tons of material, and then a painter came and paints it away. After this Biennale, I read an interview he gave, and he said, poor architects, they have to work with tons of materials. It takes months to build it. I just come with 10 rolls of paper, and I change in 2 days everything which is around me. Peter Kogler.
I think I never said it about architects and architecture. That's something that Wolfie has wrongly. But we met in December at a party, birthday party of a friend of us, and he told me and Gregor, it was after midnight and we had several drinks, that we have to come to LA and give a speech about open systems. So, and he's a really good friend, and it's a super school. I like LA, so of course I said yes. But on the next day there was the problem, what should I talk about open systems? So I thought maybe the best is to start with the pin wall I have in my studio. So in my studio is a pin wall where I put everything that seems some kind of interesting to me from very different fields. Maybe on the first view not linked to art, but so it's a mixture of everything, out of newspapers, copies from the internet. For example, this is a watercolor of a tulip, very nice tulip from the 17th century. And you find it, of course, in art history because it's in a lot of paintings like Rubens and all of the Dutch flower painters. But you also find it in books about economy. So the name of this flower is Semper Augustus, and it's considered to be the first thing having caused a bulb or economic crash. So this kind of flower was a very prestigious thing in the so-called golden age of the Netherlands, and ladies would wear it like jewelry for parties or dinners or whatsoever, and the demand was very high. So this flowers and the onions had been very expensive. So I think the most expensive was this one, Semper Augustus, and they sold 3 onions of this flower for 30,000 guldens, which doesn't mean anything to us. But I remembered that at the same time Rembrandt bought a house in the best street of Amsterdam for 12,000 guldens, and he was never able to pay it down. So Shukhov radio tower, 1922, woven steel profiles. And here on the corner, Ernst Mach, a very important Viennese philosopher, the view from the eye into the space. This is CERN, where they are kind of trying to do a kind of Big Bang. And the Higgs boson, and it's considered to be the most complex site ever built. And I had a show in Geneva and had the chance to go there and to see that. And in all the articles about this site, they speak about the cathedral. And it's really something that you kind of realize when you're in the space, that it's not something that one person has done, it's a collective thing. This is an ant nest in Brazil, the leafcutter ant, considered the most sophisticated species of ants. It's a city like this has about 3.5 million inhabitants. It goes 10 meters down. The corridors are 90 meters long, absolutely straight, air conditioning plus minus 1 degree. So it's a kind of very complex system. So I switch to my things now. This is a little movie I've done in the early 80s. I always had a Super 8 camera, and I was in a friend's house in Italy, and there was this ant running over a newspaper. And 10 years later, it turned out to be a kind of important little movie I've made. I didn't recognize when I've done it. The important thing, I think, is the relation. It's a body, it's an organism in relation to information. That's the first thing I've done in a gallery. This is 79. It was called 5-minute exhibition. That's me in a kind of pot, and the air. The pot is also under earth. It's a kind of late hippie piece, maybe. And I show it because it's kind of symptomatic for the art when I started in the late 70s. Everything was about conceptual art and performance, and nobody really made objects. So it was more or less art without any kind of things that you could deal with. This is one aspect. The other aspect is that I'm from Austria, and there is this kind of specific tradition from Viennese Actionism, which was a very dramatic and aggressive sort of performance, and it could be read as a kind of ironic comment on that too. And then, when I just got familiar with conceptual art and these kind of intellectual things, painting came back. So, this was very irritating for me, but at the same time, I was interested in images and in painting. So I started with very simple things, like trousers, shirts. Then a kind of notion of ornament appeared. This is just ink on paper, very simple materials. And then I got very interested in movies, especially movies from the 20s, German expressionist movies. For example, this is a quote from a Fritz Lang movie, The Testimony of Dr. Mabuse. There is this kind of seance. And Lang was especially interesting because his background is, he was educated as an architect, and architecture plays a central role in all his movies. I mean, it's the most obvious is Metropolis. Ink on paper, reds, a frame. the frame is somehow the border between the wall and the painting. So the wall was always part of my work. This is charcoal on cardboard, also very simple materials. It's a modular system, corner pieces, straight pieces, and with that, these bigger objects are assembled. This was a piece for Berlin. Here is this link, pretty obvious to this German movies from the 20s. So this is 83, 84, and at that time the Macintosh appeared. So I was working with extreme low-tech material. So charcoal and cardboard is the most simple material that you can choose. But at the same time, I had the feeling that I saw the Mac at a fair for office machines, and it was really fascinating to have this kind of mouse, and then something would happen on the screen. And the first Mac was black and white, and so I had the feeling that this kind of visual language I developed with this simple material is somehow compatible with this new media. So these are drawings with charcoal, and these are the first silk screens I did with computers. So somehow it's the same visual language, but it's now done with a high-tech material. And for me, it was clear that this is going to be a very important step in terms of producing images. So the great thing was there was almost no kind of, the media had no history in terms of art. But at the same time, it was clear that this is going to change a lot. You could do the things on the computer, but there was no possibility to print it out. That's the reason why I still worked with silk screen, and it's done in a modular system. I had small screens, and I would add it on the canvas. And I would print it on the floor and wash the screen under the shower. And in the late 80s, we moved to LA. So this is a map of LA. You see the resolution. So this is really the stone age of graphic machines. But I was also interested on this kind of rough surface. This was the studio. This was south of the Colosseum. This was a show at Kuhn-Schmidt, the gallery in LA. And it's painting like pieces, and there the background is extended to the wall. This is 89. Kind of anatomical motifs. The one that stayed is the brain. The first ants, 81. Still silk screen, but now it's done in posters. So it's a grid on the wall, and then you would have five elements, straight ones, corners, intersections. With that, you would build up the maze. This is Documenta 92, the entrance hall. So the ants are back. This is 10 years after this movie. And people would queue up to get into the museum, and inside you would have these streets of ants. And somehow I ended up very often in either entrance halls or staircases. So my art was never in kind of classical exhibition spaces. It was always in a kind of transition rooms, which I kind of enjoy. Tubes. So this is all based on orthogonal systems. That's the Biennale piece with Wolf. It's also this tube structure, but in this case, it's printed over advertisement posters. I asked a company to give me the leftover advertisement posters and overprinted them. So he had two layers of information. One was this kind of information from the street, the other one, this kind of grid. San Marco Square, also a Biennale in Venice. Woven fabric. That's a collaboration with Franz West. The title is Hirn mit Ei. He did the kind of furniture. I did the patterns, this brain fabric. The weaving machine, this is done with Chacard weaving machines. The weaving machine was invented in the 19th century in the 30s, and it was the first digital machine, because you had this kind of paper things with the holes. That's how the information was transformed to the machine. Mike Kelly on the piece. West. The Schindler House, Mackey House. Secession. So this is the first example for a piece that is not following an orthogonal grid, because the space itself is already such a strong grid. And here you probably can see the relationship between the actual space and how the paper on the wall, which is just this very thin skin, is changing the notion of space. So when Wolf mentioned the Baroque copulas, I think that it really has to do with this relation of an actual space to a kind of illusion of a space. Staircase. This is Documenta 10, the entrance hall. I mean, this is still all CX screen. At this time, there was no large-scale digital print, so it's all based on modular systems. This was 16 people applying 3 weeks also. I had plans, 50 meters of plans, where what part goes. And all my pieces are untitled. And the Documenta piece, which was 97, in all the reviews, they spoke about the visualization of the internet. And if I would have done the piece 5 years before or 5 years later, nobody would have talked about that. So I think this is a good example how meaning is established. It's a place and a moment. This is all a collaboration with Elfi Semotan, a very good photographer from Vienna. This is not Photoshop. It's really girls jumping on a roof in New York. It's actual photos. This is late 90s, interactive computer. It's done for a computer interface named The Cave, where wall, floor, and ceiling is projected, and you can navigate through it. And you have 3D glasses. So this is 15 years ago. This time it was pretty sophisticated. Now you can do it on any PlayStation. They even programmed the kind of gravity. And my favorite feature was you could shrink the space like Alice in Wonderland. Skater track. But not very good skaters. This is in Vienna. This was a gallery show with a moving floor. You could step on them, but it was very difficult to get off. Toronto. This is Kunsthaus Bregenz, this building by Zumthor. This was the first 360-degree projection piece. And this is 2000, and at that time it was not possible to synchronize 12 projectors. But from the wallpaper pieces, I had this technique with repetition. So this is a kind of 12 times the same image and the left edge is always fitting with the right one. And if you're in the space really starts to rotate or to drop because your whole visual. We're going to see more of that later. So 2001, it was possible large-scale digital print. Projection piece. This was a projection piece in Sweden. This is, again, 10 years after documented. Our ants are back, this time running. Steel tank. Same in Frankfurt. This is Hanover, a wallpaper piece. The space can be lit in red or in green, and the light is changing every 2 minutes. So when the light is changing, you would see that. Because the ends are printed in red and the tubes in green. So it's very simple, but very efficient. So in a very short moment, the space is changing completely. Glass tables, a glass facade in Innsbruck. It's the city hall by Dominique Perrault. And it's the south facade, and on a sunny day, you would see the pattern all over the space because of the shadow. Railway station in Graz. Well, when I spoke about entrance halls and staircases, the kind of equivalent in a city is railway stations or airports. That's the airport in Vienna. Parking house. Railway subway station in Munich. This was an exhibition in Cologne. And it was the Kunstverein, and the building has these huge glass windows, and from the street you would see the installation inside. So at night, these huge rats would walk by. That's the inside. Shanghai, Basel, Toulouse. It's a bridge by Mansart over the Garonne. These are temporary projects. This was just for. It took them 3 weeks to set it up, and the show was also 3 weeks. This is a skate park in Paris. The good ones get up into Scandinavia. That's a project with Wolf, a house in Austria, in Millstadt. And Wolf asked me to do a curtain for the building. Wolfsburg, museum for cars. Miami. Carpets, Istanbul. And this was a show in Vienna, the first kind of overview show with also with old work. So the gray paintings are from the 80s. They are from 86. And this was an installation with panels that could store light. So on the ceiling you had projectors and you would build up with light this ant streets and trails. And this was the ground floor, again a huge projection piece. You're gonna miss your flight. The sound is always by Franz Baumhassler, an artist friend of mine. Lissabon. This is a research center in Vienna for molecular medicine. I was asked to do the glass facade. This is in Ireland, a friend of us, Michael Sadke. I think Michael did the first, when was the Reisbar, 72? It was one of your first projects, right?
Yeah.
So somehow the cardboard objects are back. Now they are in steel and it's done with laser, but it's kind of linked to the very early pieces from the 80s. This is in Germany, Duisburg. It's huge and it's moving. It's with 10 big projectors. Istanbul, a gallery show. Very difficult for a gallery because there's nothing to sell. So a lot of effort to do it, but. Innsbruck. and subway station in Vienna, very close to the secession, 15 years later and now permanent. It's done in glass. This was a show in December in Thessaloniki. I think this is another example where this kind of 20s movie aesthetic is back, if you think about Caligari or certain German expressionist films. And that's a kind of computer animated work. I mean, it's a real photo, but it's moving. So the building is a cube. It's just because of the projection that the shape is constantly changing.
Thank you.